So this seminar also marks the official launch, as was already mentioned, of the report on safety in bus transport in Europe. And this study, commissioned by Public Transport Norway and carried out by the Norwegian Institute of Transport Economics, provides an overview of the status of road safety in bus transport and potential measures for drivers, passengers, and road users outside the bus, both to reduce the risks as well as to reduce the consequences if crashes do occur. It also aims to support procurers and authorities with setting good safety requirements in bus contracts and regulations. Tor-Olav Nævestad, I hope I'm pronouncing it nearly as it should be, but probably not. He's the head of research group on safety and resilience at the Institute of Transport Economics in Norway, also a much appreciated Polis member, by the way, and he's the main author of this report. And he will be sharing his findings with us. Tor-Olav, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. You can hear me loud and clear. Excellent. Yes, I've been presented quite good, so I can skip this. You can also note the names of my co-authors here. You can't, but it's Rune Elvik and Alena Høie. And the aims of the report that we are presenting now is to provide an overview of the traffic safety situation in Norway and Europe, description of necessary safety management systems and safety culture features, measures to reduce the occurrence of accident, and measures to reduce the consequences of accident. And as has been noted several times, Public Transport Norway is the commissioner of this report. And also, as has been said, the report shall give decision makers and procurers a basis for setting good and relevant requirements to increase road safety. And the point of departure from my own research, because I've been doing research on drivers at work for several years, and I see in that research that in general in Norway, drivers at work comprise 36% of the fatal accidents. Of course, bus drivers and people in bus transport are a little group in that one. But what we see also that increased measures to increase the safety of drivers at work are very effective. They can lead to 20 to 60% reduction in accident risks. And also the employment relationship of drivers at work legitimizes implementing a lot of measures against them more than private drivers. But we see nevertheless that organizations with drivers at work do relatively little, not as much as they could. And bus companies are an exception, but we also see variation between the bus companies, so they can improve also. And what I've been grappling about for 12 years or so is, what is the solution then? Because there is no legal requirement for systematic safety management and safety culture work in the road sector. Other transport sectors like aviation, rail and maritime sector have such requirements to safety management systems. But when we discuss this in a national context in European countries, they say that we cannot introduce requirements to, for instance, ISO 39001, road safety management in the road sector, because that would violate between the requirements for equal conditions for competitions. So my conclusion then several times has been that in order to get such systems in road sector organization, a third party have to require it, like a public transport authority. And here's an example of a public transport authority, Ruter, the largest one in Norway. We have done several studies of Ruter, and I'm giving this example just to show the changes that can occur and what can be done. There was mentioned a fatal accident here with where a bus driver died in low speed, and after that, probably Ruter commissioned a report from us, and the title of the report was "How can Ruter work with road safety?" And we did interviews with people in Ruter, and at that time there was a strong focus on the fact that Ruter has no formal responsibility for traffic safety, and there was a concern of becoming responsible. This is also a typical attitude among some regulatory authorities, that they say, we don't want to specify too much because then we can become responsible. And then another attitude that was common was, we assume that the bus company follow Norwegian law and that the Road Traffic Act is a good enough road safety requirement. And the Road Safety Act places responsibility on the individual driver, i.e. the bus driver, not the company. And then we also had a seminar in 2020. Interesting to think of that seminar and stand here today, because then we discussed the accident where the bus driver died at low speed. We discussed how can we get requirements for collision protection of bus drivers. And then everyone agreed that it has to go through the EU and it will take a lot of time. And now we stand here today, and the occasion is that the Norwegian authority has made such a legal requirement, and that's interesting. So coming back to Ruter in 2020, after that study, we saw a great development, which means that Ruter takes a more holistic role to contribute to increased traffic safety, and they require ISO 39001 safety management system and systematic work with safety culture. And Ruter also works to establish a system for learning from incidents, a learning culture, and also requirement for collision protection. So this shows what is possible. And I'm mentioning this example because it shows a great development when it comes to setting requirements for road safety and taking responsibility and driving the industry forward in a way which raises the bar. And this shows what public transport authorities can do to improve road safety. And also, of course, there are a lot of people here today who have been involved in this process, which are the trade unions, employers association, accident investigation board, bus operators, and so on. And so this is a good example to other countries, other sectors, and other transport buyers. And that was a lot of slides for background. I hope that I have some time more to talk about the report. The report includes data on accidents and accidents risk, and we see, as we see in other studies, that the risk is it's being decreased for accidents, and you will see that in the report. Another thing that is important to note is that there is a high proportion of vulnerable road users in accident with buses, especially pedestrians. And also another very important fact, when we look at accidents in bus transport and injuries in bus transport, 80 to 85 of these injuries happen on board with passengers on board or going on and off the bus. And as we also have been discussing, we see that the risk of accident involvement for bus drivers is approximately the same as passenger car drivers. But as we have been talking about, knowing that the consequences can be fatal at low speed is a problematic. And in the report, we analyze a lot of road safety measures, and then we subject them to this table, analysis according to this table. We do a qualitative assessment and quantitative assessment. So we search for all road safety measures that can be implemented in bus transport, and then we look at the measures and the reports, and then we look at the reports, and then we say, is this measure studied in bus transport? If it is, some measures only studied in truck transport, for example, and that is relevant, but to some extent. But if it has been studied in bus transport, it gets 2 points. And if it reduces accidents with a large effect, it gets 3 points. And then we also assess how uncertain is the effect here. Are there only one bad study, or are there a lot of high quality studies? With low uncertainty, it's 3 points. Then we check whether the measure is in conflict with other measures, and then whether it is relevant to the accident picture which has been presented in the report. I will give an example here. Fleet management systems to register the driving style of drivers. It gets 11.5 points. This is a measure that is studied on buses. And a high quality study shows that it reduces accidents up to 20%, can do that. And the uncertainty is relatively low. And this measure is not in conflict with other measures, but rather it can lead to reduced emissions. And it is also very relevant for the accident picture because it can reduce accidents happening with people outside the bus, and also avoid injuries inside the bus because you get a more smooth driving style. And then this is the structure of the report. We evaluate 33 specific measures in the way that I've showed in this table. And these are the measures. There is one chapter for organizational measures, measures addressing onboard passenger safety, crashworthiness and driver protection, driver assisting systems, and so on. I guess there are enough copies of the report for all of you to delve more into these issues. And then, if we go through the report and we have read all the pages with these different sections, with all the measures, we have the job of sort of, well, what should we recommend based on this? We make a large table where we give points to all of the measures and see who's on top and who's got the lowest one. And then one of the issues is that we review all measures. But some of these measures are already implemented, so it's no point to come with recommendations about them. But our point of departure is that we end up by recommending measures that are very efficient, but are not required yet. So then they are not fully implemented, and then they should be required and implemented. And these are type of measures that some companies might have, but not all companies. And so making requirements on them would raise the bar in bus transport. And here are the recommended measures that are not required yet. Fleet management system to record driving style, safety culture measures, safety management systems, and crash protection for bus drivers. And as noted, safety culture measures and safety management measures are required in other transport sectors with a high safety level, like aviation, rail, and the maritime sector. And then our second point in these conclusions are that there are some required measures that probably are not fully implemented, as far as I know. These are measures where it would be relevant to find measures to increase their implementations. This implies, for instance, seatbelt use among bus passengers. I've seen different numbers there from Norway. And then the final slide here. How is the timer now? I feel that I'm very efficient.
You can continue.
Yes. Yes, I was just showing that I'm responsive. One of the challenges that we have, or one of the biases that we have as researchers, is that we read things that are published in scientific papers, and that those things are generally old, because you have to develop a measure, and then you develop a study, and then you publish a study, and that takes a lot of time. So we're sort of conservative and lagging behind when we review safety measures in bus transport. So we rate existing and older measures higher, because the longer the technology has been there, the more studies are there potentially say that it is efficient. So I tried, how can I compensate for that? And we do that by highlighting measures which seem promising, but where there is little research that is relevant or current versions of the technology is not fully developed yet, indicating a need for further research. This especially applies to geofence speed limiter, which seems to be a very good idea, but where we have seen from the things we have evaluated that there are some practical challenges and not many studies of that yet. Also, warning system for vulnerable road users, runover guards, measures to prevent fall accidents, and so on. That's a challenging issue because it could be attacked from many different angles, but it is the most important issue, the most important source of injuries among bus passengers. So that's a nice and important area for future research. I think it feels natural to stop now.
Thanks a lot to Olaf for your extensive overview, and congratulations on the study, of course. Are there any questions from the audience that you would like to ask with regard to the report that has just been presented and is now officially launched? Don't be shy. Do we have a microphone? Yes, it's coming your way. And please also shortly introduce yourself.
Good afternoon, and thank you. I'm Simon Castle. I'm from Transport for London. I'll say straight away I'm quite new there, so I'm about to talk about something, the work of my colleagues rather than myself. But the geofencing speed limiter that we have, we call it ISA, Intelligent Speed Adaptation, is geofenced, is also actively retarding the vehicle. So it's not just about limiting the acceleration, it slows it down. And we've got that fitted to over 1,000 buses now. And what we found is that it's because of the number of buses we've got, it's slowing the rest of traffic down too. And the other benefit is that when you're working with things like the sort of crash mitigation measures on board, high back seats and so on, they're all much more effective at a lower speed. So it's that holistic approach that you're talking about there is absolutely key when you get all the measures working together. Not a question, I'm afraid, but an observation.
Yes. Thank you. That's a good comment. But what you've seen from the concrete applications that we have studied is that also bus drivers find it a bit disturbing because there's speed, they're being slowed down, they're being controlled by a third party in a way, and it could also be strained for passengers. So it's, I guess it needs to adapt in some way, and perhaps the drivers need to adapt. But when you work with road safety, you always like measures that control and reduce and so on. So it seems like a good idea.
We also see that effectively more and more cities are introducing 30 kilometers per hour as the standard speed limit in urban areas. There has been some pushback that this would reduce the commercial speed of the vehicles, but effectively I think also very often the speed isn't higher than 30 anyway in urban cores. Have you also looked at those types of more city-driven measures?
No, what we focus on is more measures that are related to the bus and not so much like external things like speed limits, but it's definitely relevant. I think we mentioned some of those measures, but not... And also, it's... When we look at the... We discussed the issues related to ISA, for instance, and then we see that too high speed for condition is not very prevalent risk factor in bus accidents, as far as I remember. So as you say, the speed is quite low anyway.
Yeah, but definitely it shows the importance of a holistic approach, as was just being mentioned as well. Any further comments or questions with regard to the report? Not at the moment. Well, we'll be coming back to your report several times in the course of this afternoon. Maybe one question from my side to conclude. When you look at transport authorities across Europe, do you see that generally there is a reluctance to step in when it comes to improving safety, or rather the other way around? Are they all as dynamic and forward-looking as Rutter, for example?
Yes, I think that's a question I would hope that the audience would like to say, because when you are a public transport buyer, you are in a position to have an overview of all the transport you buy and how the buses interact with the road and so on. So I would like to, I don't know, is what I told about after 2020 typical? Any comments on that?
Well, if not now, we have a panel coming up later on several public transport authorities from across Europe, so I'm sure we will be hearing their views later on. But thank you very much for presenting the report. Great job. And yes, please join me in thanking